Dedication and Preface of Toxophilus. Toxophilus by Roger Ascham, edited by J. A. Giles. Dedication and Preface. To the most gracious and our most dread sovereign lord, King Henry the VIII, by the grace of God, King of England, France, and Ireland, defender of the faith and of the Church of England and also of Ireland, in earth's supreme head next unto Christ, be all health, victory, and felicity. What time, as most gracious prince, your highness, this last year past, took that your most honourable and victorious journey into France, accompanied with such a part of the nobility and yeomanry of England as neither hath been like known by experience, nor yet read of in history, accompanied also with the daily prayers, good hearts, and wills of all and every one of your grace's subjects left behind you here at home in England. The same time, I, being at my book in Cambridge, sorry that my little ability could stretch out no better to help forward so noble an enterprise, yet with my good will, prayer, and heart, nothing behind him that was foremost of all, conceived a wonderful desire, by the prayer, wishing, talking, and communication that was in every man's mouth for your grace's most victorious return, to offer up something at your homecoming to your highness, which should be both a token of my love and duty towards your majesty, and also a sign of my good mind and zeal towards my country. This occasion, given to me at that time, caused me to take in hand again this little purpose of shooting, begun of me before, yet not ended then, for other studies, more meet for that trade of living which God and my friends have set me unto. But when your grace's most joyful and happy victory prevented my daily and speedy diligence to perform this matter, I was compelled to wait another time, to prepare and offer up this little book unto your majesty. And when it hath pleased your highness, of your infinite goodness, and also your most honourable counsel, to know and peruse over the contents and some part of this book, and so to allow it, that other men might read it, through the furtherance and setting forth of the right worshipful, and my singular good master, Sir William Paget, knight, most worthy secretary to your highness, and most open and ready succour to all poor, honest, learned men's suits, I most humbly beseech your grace to take in good worth this little treatise, purposed, begun, and ended of me, only for this intent, that labour, honest pastime, and virtue might recover again that place and right that idleness, unthrift, gaming, and vice have put them from. And although to have written this book either in Latin or Greek, which thing I would be very glad yet to do, if I might surely know your grace's pleasure therein, had been more easy and fit for my trade in study, yet, nevertheless, I, supposing it no point of honesty that my commodity should stop and hinder any part either of the pleasure or profit of many, have written this English matter in the English tongue, for Englishmen, where in this I trust that your grace, if it please your highness to read it, shall perceive it to be a thing honest for me to write, pleasant for some to read, and profitable for many to follow, containing a pastime honest for the mind, wholesome for the body, fit for every man, vile for no man, using the day and open place for honesty to rule it, not lurking in corners for misorder to abuse it. Therefore I trust it shall appear to be both a sure token of my zeal to set forward shooting, and some sign of my mind towards honesty and learning. Thus I will trouble your grace no longer, but with my daily prayer I will beseech God to preserve your grace in all health and felicity, to the fear and overthrow of all your enemies, to the pleasure, joyfulness, and succour of all your subjects, to the utter destruction of papistry and heresy, to the continual setting forth of God's word and his glory. Your grace's most bounden scholar, Roger Ascham. To all gentlemen and yeomen of England. Bias, the wise man, came to Croesus, the rich king, on a time when he was making new ships, purposing to have subdued by water the out isles lying betwixt Greece and Asia Minor. "What news now in Greece?" said the king to Bias. "None other news but these," said Bias, "that the isles of Greece prepared a wonderful company of horsemen to overrun Lydia withal." "There is nothing under heaven," saith the king, "that I would so soon wish, as that they durst be so bold to meet us on the land with horse, And think you, said Bias, that there is anything which they would sooner wish than that you should be so fond to meet them on the water with ships? And so Croesus, hearing not the true news, but perceiving the wise man's mind and counsel, both gave then over making of his ships, and left also behind him a wonderful example for all commonwealths to follow, that is, evermore to regard and set most by that thing whereunto nature hath made them most apt, and use hath made them most fit. By this matter I mean the shooting in the longbow for Englishmen, which thing, with all my heart, I do wish, if I were of authority, I would counsel all the gentlemen and yeomen of England not to change it with any other thing, how good soever it seems to be, but that still, according to the old wont of England, youth should use it for the most honest pastime in peace, that men might handle it as a most sure weapon in war. Other strong weapons, which both experience doth prove to be good, and the wisdom of the King's Majesty and his council provides to be had, are not ordained to take away shooting, but that both not compared together, whether one should be better than the other, but so joined together that the one should be always an aid and help for the other, might so strengthen the realm on all sides that no kind of enemy in any kind of weapon might pass and go beyond us. For this purpose I, partly provoked by the counsel of some gentlemen, partly moved by the love which I have always borne towards shooting, have written this little treatise, wherein, if I have not satisfied any man, I trust he will the rather be content with my doing, because I am, I suppose, the first which hath said anything in this matter, and few beginnings be perfect, said the wise men, and also because if I have said amiss, I am content that any man amend it, or if I have said too little, any man that will, to add what him pleaseth to it. My mind is, in profiting and pleasing every man, to hurt or displease no man, intending none other purpose but that youth might be stirred to labour, honest pastime, and virtue, and, as much as lieth in me, plucked from idleness, unthrifty games, and vice. Which thing I have laboured only in this book, showing how fit shooting is for all kinds of men, how honest a pastime for the mind, how wholesome an exercise for the body, not vile for great men to use, not costly for poor men to sustain, not lurking in holes and corners for ill men at their pleasure to misuse it, but abiding in the open sight and face of the world, for good men, if it fault, by their wisdom to correct it. And here I would desire all gentlemen and yeomen to use this pastime in such a mean that the outrageousness of great gaming should not hurt the honesty of shooting, which of his own nature is always joined with honesty, yet for men's faults oftentimes blamed unworthily, as all good things have been, and evermore shall be. If any man would blame me, either for taking such a matter in hand, or else for writing it in the English tongue, this answer I may make him, that when the best of the realm think it honest for them to use, I, one of the meanest sort, ought not to suppose it vile for me to write. And though to have written it in another tongue had been both more profitable for my study and also more honest for my name, yet I can think my labour well bestowed, if with a little hindrance to my profit and name, may come any furtherance to the pleasure or commodity of the gentlemen and yeomen of England, for whose sake I took this matter in hand. And as for the Latin or Greek tongue, everything is so excellently done in them that none can do better. In the English tongue, contrary, everything in a manner so meanly both for the matter and handling that no man can do worse. For therein the least learned, for the most part, have been always most ready to write, and they which had least hope in Latin have been most bold in English, when surely every man that is most ready to talk is not most able to write. He that will write well in any tongue must follow this counsel of Aristotle, to speak as the common people do, to think as wise men do, and so should every man understand him, and the judgment of wise men allow him. Many English writers have not done so, but using strange words as Latin, French, and Italian, to make all things dark and hard. Once I communed with a man which reasoned the English tongue to be enriched and increased thereby, saying, "Who will not praise that feast where a man shall drink at a dinner both wine, ale, and beer?" "Truly," quoth I, "they be all good, every one taken by himself alone, but if you put Malmsey and Sack, red wine and white, ale and beer, and all in one pot, you shall make a drink neither easy to be known, nor yet wholesome for the body. Cicero, in following Socrates, Plato, and Demosthenes, increased the Latin tongue after another sort. This way, because divers men that write do not know, they can neither follow it because of their ignorance, nor yet will praise it for very arrogancy. Two faults, seldom the one out of the other's company. English writers, by diversity of time, have taken diverse matters in hand. In our father's time, nothing was read but books of feigned chivalry, wherein a man, by reading, should be led to none other end but only to manslaughter and bawdry. If any man suppose they were good enough to pass the time withal, he is deceived. For surely vain words do work no small thing in vain, ignorant, and young minds, especially if they be given anything thereunto of their own nature. These books, as I have heard say, were made the most part in abbeys and monasteries, a very likely and fit fruit of such an idle and blind kind of living. In our time, now, when every man is given to know much, rather than to live well, very many do write, but after such a fashion as very many do shoot. Some shooters take in hand stronger bows than they be able to maintain. This thing maketh them sometime to outshoot the mark, sometime to shoot far wide, and perchance hurt some that look on. Other, that never learned to shoot, nor yet knoweth good shaft nor bow, will be as busy as the best, but such one commonly plucketh down aside, and crafty archers which be against him will be both glad of him, and also ever ready to lay and bet with him. It were better for such one to sit down than shoot. Other there be which have very good bow and shafts, and good knowledge in shooting, but they have been brought up in such evil-favoured shooting that they can neither shoot fair nor yet near. If any man will apply these things together, he shall not see the one far differ from the other. And I, also among all other, in writing this little treatise, have followed some young shooters, which both will begin to shoot for a little money, and also will use to shoot once or twice about the mark for naught before they begin a good. And therefore I did take this little matter in hand, to assay myself, and hereafter, by the grace of God, if the judgment of wise men that look on think that I can do any good, I may perchance cast my shaft among other for better game. Yet in writing this book, some men will marvel perchance why that I, being an unperfect shooter, should take in hand to write of making a perfect archer. The same man, peradventure, will marvel how a whetstone which is blunt can make the edge of a knife sharp. I would the same man should consider also that in going about any matter there be four things to be considered: doing, saying, thinking, and perfectness. First, there is no man that doeth so well but he can say better, or else some men, which now be stark naught, should be too good. Again, no man can utter with his tongue so well as he is able to imagine with his mind, and yet perfectness itself is far above all thinking. Then, seeing that saying is one step nearer perfectness than doing, let every man leave marvelling why my word shall rather express than my deed shall perform perfect shooting. I trust no man will be offended with this little book, except it be some fletchers and bowyers, thinking hereby that many that love shooting shall be taught to refuse such naughty wares as they would utter. Honest fletchers and bowyers do not so, and they that be unhonest ought rather to amend themselves for doing ill than being angry with me for saying well. A fletcher hath even so good a quarrel to be angry with an archer that refuseth an ill shaft, as a bladesmith hath to a fletcher that forsaketh to buy of him a naughty knife. For as an archer must be content that a fletcher know a good shaft in every point for the perfect and making of it, so an honest fletcher will be content that a shooter know a good shaft in every point for the perfect using of it, because the one knoweth like a fletcher how to make it, the other knoweth like an archer how to use it. And seeing the knowledge is one in them both, yet the end diverse, surely that fletcher is an enemy to archers and artillery, which cannot be content that an archer know a shaft as well for his use in shooting as he himself should know a shaft for his advantage in selling. and the rather because shafts be not made so much to be sold, but chiefly to be used. And seeing that use and occupying is the end by which a shaft is made, the making, as it were, a means for occupying, surely the knowledge in every point of a good shaft is more to be required in a shooter than a fletcher. Yet, as I said before, no honest fletcher will be angry with me, seeing I do not teach how to make a shaft, which belongeth only to a good fletcher, but to know and handle a shaft, which belongeth to an archer. And this little book, I trust, shall please and profit both parties, for good bows and shafts shall be better known to the commodity of all shooters, and good shooting may, perchance, be the more occupied to the profit of all bowyers and fletchers. And thus I pray God that all fletchers getting their living truly, and all archers using shooting honestly, and all manner of men that favour artillery may live continually in health and merriness, obeying their prince as they should, and loving God as they ought, to whom for all things be all honour and glory for ever. Amen. End of Dedication and Preface. Book 1, Part 1 of Toxophilus. Toxophilus by Roger Ascham, edited by J. A. Giles. The First Book of the School of Shooting, Part 1. Philologus said, "You study too sore, Toxophile." Toxophilus said, "I will not hurt myself overmuch, I warrant you." Philologus said, "Take heed you do not. For we physicians say that it is neither good for the eyes in so clear a sun, nor yet wholesome for the body so soon after meat to look upon a man's book." Toxophilus said, "In eating and studying I will never follow any physic, for if I did, I am sure I should have small pleasure in the one, and less courage in the other. But what news drave you hither, I pray you?" Philologus said, "Small news, truly. But as I came on walking, I fortuned to come with three or four that went to shoot at the bricks, and when I saw not you amongst them, but at the last espied you looking on your book here so sadly, I thought to come and hold you with some communication, lest your book should run away with you, for methought by your wavering pace and earnest looking, your book led you, not you it." Toxophilus said, "Indeed, as it chanced, my mind went faster than my feet, for I happened here to read in Phaedro Platonis a place that entreats wonderfully of the nature of souls, which place, whether it were for the passing eloquence of Plato and the Greek tongue, or for the high and godly description of the matter, kept my mind so occupied that it had no leisure to look at my feet, for I was reading how some souls, being well feathered, flew always about heaven and heavenly matters. Other some, having their feathers moted away and drooping, sank down into earthly things." Philologus said, "I remember the place very well, and it is wonderfully said of Plato, and now I see it was no marvel though your feet failed you, seeing your mind flew so fast." Toxophilus said, "I'm glad now that you letted me, for my head aches with looking on it, and because you tell me so, I am very sorry that I was not with those good fellows you spake upon, for it is a very fair day for a man to shoot in." Philologus said, "And methinks you are a great deal better occupied, and in better company, for it is a very fair day for a man to go to his book in." Toxophilus said, "All days and weathers will serve for that purpose, and surely this occasion was ill lost." Philologus said, "Yea, but clear weather maketh clear minds, and it is best, as I suppose, to spend the best time upon the best things. And methought you shot very well, and at that mark which every good scholar should most busily shoot at. And I suppose it be a great deal more pleasure also to see a soul fly in Plato than a shaft fly at the bricks. I grant you, shooting is not the worst thing in the world. Yet if we shoot, and time shoot, we are not like to be great winners at the length. And you know also we scholars have more earnest and weighty matters in hand, nor we be not born to pastime and play, as you know well enough who saith." Toxophilus said, "Yet the same man in the same place, Philology, by your leave, doth admit wholesome, honest, and manly pastimes to be as necessary to be mingled with sad matters of the mind, as eating and sleeping is for the health of the body, and yet we be born for neither of both. And Aristotle himself saith that although it were a fond and a childish thing to be too earnest in pastime and play, yet doth he affirm by the authority of the old poet Epicharmus that a man may use play for earnest matter's sake, and in another place that as rest is for labour and medicines for health, so is pastime at times for sad and weighty study. Philologus said, how much in this matter is to be given to the authority either of Aristotle or Tully, I cannot tell, seeing sad men may well enough speak merrily for a merry matter. This I am sure, which thing this fair wheat, God save it, maketh me remember, that those husbandmen which rise earliest and come late home, and are content to have their dinner and other drinkings brought into the field to them for fear of losing of time, have fatter barns in harvest than they which will either sleep at noontime of the day, or else make merry with their neighbours at the ale. And so a scholar that purposeth to be a good husband, and desireth to reap and enjoy much fruit of learning, must till and sow thereafter. Our best seed-time, which be scholars, as it is very timely, and when we be young, so it endureth not over long, and therefore it may not be let slip 1 hour. Our ground is very hard and full of weeds, our horse wherewith will be drawn very wild, as Plato saith, and infinite other mullets which will make a thrifty scholar take heed how he spendeth his time in sport and play. Toxophilus said that Aristotle and Tully speak earnestly and as they thought, the earnest matter which they entreat upon doth plainly prove. And as for your husbandry, it was more probably told without words proper to the thing than thoroughly proved with reasons belonging to our matter. For, contrariwise, I heard myself, a good husband at his book, once say that to omit study some time of the day and some time of the year made as much for the increase of learning as to let the land lie some time fallow maketh for the better increase of corn. This we see, if the land be ploughed every year, the corn cometh thin up, the ear is short, the grain is small, and when it is brought into the barn and threshed, giveth very evil fall. So those which never leave poring on their books have oftentimes as thin invention as other poor men have, and a small wit and weight in it as other men's. And thus your husbandry, methinks, is more like the life of a covetous snudge that oft very evil proves than the labour of a good husband that knoweth well what he doth. And surely the best wits to learning must needs have much recreation and ceasing from their book, or else they mar themselves, when base and dumpish wits can never be hurt with continual study. As you see in luting that a treble minikin string must always be let down, but at such time as when a man must needs play, when the base and dull string needeth never to be moved out of his place. The same reason I find true in 2 bows that I have, whereof one is quick of cast, trick and trim, both for pleasure and profit. The other is a lug, slow of cast, following the string, more sure for to last than pleasant to use. Now, sir, it chanced this other night that one in my chamber would needs bend them to prove their strength, but I cannot tell how they were both left bent till the next day at after dinner. And when I came to them, purposing to have gone on shooting, I found my good bow clean cast on the one side, and as weak as water, that surely if I were a rich man I had rather spent a crown. And as for my lug, it was not one whit the worse, but shot by and by as well and as far as ever it did. And even so I am sure that good wits, except they be let down like a treble string and unbent like a good casting bow, they will never last and be able to continue in study. And I know where I speak this, philology, for I would not say this much afore young men, for they will take some occasion to study little enough. But I say it therefore because I know, as little study getteth little learning, or none at all, so the most study getteth not the most learning of all. For a man's wit sore occupied in earnest study must be well recreated with some honest pastime, as the body sore laboured must be refreshed with sleep and quietness, or else it cannot endure very long. As the noble poet saith, what thing wants quiet and merry rest endures but a small while. And I promise you, shooting, by my judgment, is the most honest pastime of all, and such one I am sure of all other that hindereth learning little or nothing at all. Whatsoever you and some others say, which are a great deal sorer against it always than you need be. Philologus said, "Hindereth learning little or nothing at all. That were a marvel to me truly, and I am sure, seeing you say so, you have some reason wherewith you can defend shooting withal. And as for will, for the love that you bear towards shooting, I think there shall lack none in you. Therefore, seeing we have so good leisure both, and nobody by us to trouble us, and you so willing and able to defend it, and I so ready and glad to hear what may be said of it, I suppose we cannot pass the time better over, neither you for the honesty of your shooting, nor I for mine own mind's sake, than to see what can be said with it or against it, and specially in these days when so many doth use it, and every man in a manner doth commune of it." Toxophilus said, "To speak of shooting, Philologe, truly, I would I were so able, either as I myself am willing, or yet as the matter deserveth. But seeing with wishing we cannot have one now worthy, which so worthy a thing can worthily praise, and although I had rather have any other do it than myself, yet myself rather than no other, I will not fail to say in it what I can. Wherein, if I say little, lay that of my little ability, not of the matter itself, which deserveth no little thing to be said of it." Philologus said, "If it deserve no little thing to be said of it, Toxophile, I marvel how it chanceth that no man hitherto hath written anything of it, wherein you must grant me that either the matter is naught, unworthy and barren to be written upon, or else some men are to blame which both love it and use it, and yet could never find in their heart to say one good word of it, seeing that very trifling matters hath not lacked great learned men to set them out, as gnats and nuts, and many other more like things. Wherefore, either you may honestly lay very great fault upon men, because they never yet praised it, or else I may justly take away no little thing from shooting, because it never yet deserved it." Toxophilus said, "Truly herein, Philologe, you take not so much from it as you give to it. For great and commodious things are never greatly praised, not because they be not worthy, but because their excellency needs no man's praise, having all their commendation of themselves, not borrowed of other men's lips, which rather praise themselves in speaking much of a little thing than that matter which they entreat upon. Great and good things be not praised, for whoever praised Hercules, as the Greek proverb. And that no man hitherto hath written any book of shooting, the fault is not to be laid in the thing which was worthy to be written upon, but of men which were negligent in doing it. And this was the cause thereof, as I suppose. Men that used shooting most, and knew it best, were not learned. Men that were learned used little shooting, and were ignorant in the nature of the thing. And so few men hath been that hitherto were able to write upon it. Yet how long shooting hath continued, what commonwealths hath most used it, how honest a thing it is for all men, what kind of living soever they follow, what pleasure and profit cometh of it, both in peace and war, all manner of tongues and writers, Hebrew, Greek, and Latin, hath so plentifully spoken of it, as few other things like. So what shooting is, how many kinds there is of it, what goodness is joined with it, is told. Only how it is to be learned and brought to a perfectness among men is not told." Philologus said, "Then, Toxophile, if it be so as you do say, let us go forward and examine how plentifully this is done that you speak, and first, of the invention of it. Then, what honesty and profit is in the use of it, both for war and peace, more than in other pastimes. Last of all, how it ought to be learned among men, for the increase of it. Which thing, if you do, not only I now, for your communication, but many other more, when they shall know of it, for your labour, and shooting itself also, if it could speak, for your kindness, will thank you very much." Toxophilus said, "What good things men speak of shooting, and what good things shooting brings to men, as my wit and knowledge will serve me, gladly shall I say my mind. But how the thing is to be learned, I will surely leave to some other, which, both for greater experience in it, and also for their learning, can set it out better than I." Philologus said, "Well, as for that, I know both what you can do in shooting by experience, and that you can also speak well enough of shooting for your learning. But go on with the first part, and I do not doubt but what my desire, what your love toward it, the honesty of shooting, the profit that may come thereby to many other, shall get the second part out of you at the last." Toxophilus said, "Of the first finders out of shooting, divers men diversely do write. Claudian the poet saith that nature gave example of shooting first by the porcupine, which doth shoot his pricks, and will hit anything that fights with it. Whereby men learned afterwards to imitate the same, in finding out both bow and shafts. Pliny referreth it to Scythes, the son of Jupiter. Better and more noble writers bring shooting from a more noble inventor, as Plato, Callimachus, and Galen from Apollo. Yet long afore those days do we read it in the Bible of shooting expressly, and also, if we shall believe Nicholas de Lyra, Lamech killed Cain with a shaft. So this great continuance of shooting doth not a little praise shooting, nor that neither doth not a little set it out, that it is referred to the invention of Apollo, for which point shooting is highly praised of Galen, where he saith that mean crafts be first found out by men or beasts, as weaving by a spider, and such other, but high and commendable sciences by gods, as shooting and music by Apollo. And thus shooting, for the necessity of it used in Adam's days."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.